You know, if I weren't a diagnosed psychopath, I might feel bad for the Muslim leaders who are starting to recognize that there is absolutely nothing they can do to keep Muslims from leaving Islam. Can you imagine 14 centuries of slaughtering unbelievers in the name of Allah, raping female captives, forcing people to convert, and executing anyone who tries to leave, only to lose it all because the internet, Facebook, YouTube? While Muslims are still running around thumping their chests and screaming, "Islam is the fastest growing religion in the world," Muslim leaders are getting call after call after call. My son just said he's no longer a Muslim. My daughter just said she doesn't want to wear the hijab. And the Muslim community can't figure out what to do because they're not used to this. For 14 centuries, they would deal with apostasy through violence and intimidation. Now they can't, and there's no plan B in Islam. Bilal Philips warns the Muslim community of Canada that they're in trouble.
The Muslim community here, in a minority circumstance, is a high-risk community.
He admits that in a Muslim country, the situation is different because of the cultural pressure to conform.
Back home in our countries, where people grow up practicing Islam as a culture, as tradition, everybody conforms because of the pressure of the community, the relatives, etc.
The result is that it's rare for people to announce their apostasy in Muslim countries.
It is rare that you would find back home a young man or a young woman addressing their parents, their family, and telling them, "I don't believe in Allah."
But things are different in the West, even for Muslim parents who are raising their children to be devout Muslims.
While I was in Doha, Qatar, one sister called me from here, from a religious practicing family, Islamically active. She said, "My son memorized the Quran at the age of 10.
Obviously, a child who has memorized the entire Quran in Arabic will know that Islam is true, because the Quran is just so amazing in Arabic.
But at the age of 15, 5 years later, she's calling. She said he came home and told us that he doesn't believe in Allah.
Phillips is hearing so many stories of young people leaving Islam that he has to warn the Muslim community about the coming avalanche of apostasy.
And if we don't take constructive steps to deal with this, it is going to become an avalanche, a tsunami that is going to hit our community in such a way that we will have a very difficult time standing. It will knock us over.
An avalanche of apostasy?
An avalanche.
A tsunami of apostasy?
A tsunami.
What's it going to do?
It will knock us over.
But Bilal Philips believes that there's a solution. What's the solution, Bilal?
So this is what we have to convey to our young people. We have to connect them to the Quran intellectually, emotionally, psychologically, physically, in such a way that they have no doubt.
Connect them to the Quran so that they have no doubt? That is adorable. Bilal, young people reading the Quran is what gives them doubts, because the Quran totally contradicts everything they're told by their Muslim leaders and their Muslim parents. When young people read the Quran and they go to their Muslim leaders and their Muslim parents and they ask, why does Allah command men to beat rebellious wives? Why does Allah command us to attack Jews and Christians? Their leaders and their parents reply, oh, what Allah really meant is something completely different from what he said. And this doesn't remove doubts, it increases doubts, because the young Muslims are being told that Allah is a horrible communicator who can't say what he means. So there's no way to keep young people from doubting the Quran. What else you got, Bilal?
And also, they should know Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They should know him well.
Same mistake. How are young people going to learn about Muhammad? It had better not be by reading about him in Islam's most trusted sources, because nothing will convince Muslims to leave Islam faster than reading what Muhammad's companions said about him. So the only thing Muslim leaders and Muslim parents can do is try to convince young Muslims to believe in a fictional Muhammad, one who never existed, by giving them modern books about Muhammad that present a watered-down, whitewashed Walt Disney version of Muhammad. But that's not going to help, because there are people like us who are going to tell these young Muslims the truth about Muhammad. And we're going to be the ones who are quoting Islam's most trusted sources. And the young Muslims are going to realize that their leaders and their parents have been lying to them. And they're going to leave Islam. Hilariously, Bilal Philips gives an example of how to respond to a young Muslim's doubts about Islam. It's a disaster. Here's how he sets it up.
The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as this individual that I spoke with a few days ago raised, did not prohibit slavery. So, slavery is evil. Why not? What kind of prophet is this? God is condoning slavery?
It's not simply that Muhammad didn't prohibit slavery. It's that Muhammad bought, owned, sold, and traded slaves and had sex with his female slaves, and Muslims in the West have been told that Muhammad abolished slavery, and they're realizing that they've been lied to and that they can't trust their leaders or their parents. So, Bilal, how are you going to correct these young Muslims?
But he didn't know how Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam treated those who were slaves. The slaves who were in his household, he adopted, made them a part of his family. They loved him so much that when their own parents came, they preferred to stay with the Prophet ﷺ as a slave rather than go with their own parents.
Oh my goodness. Muhammad adopted his slaves? They didn't want to go back to their own families? There are young people who are dumb enough to fall for an answer like that. But when they go and share that answer on the internet, they're going to be in trouble. What happens if they take a closer look at Bilal's response? Here's what they'll find. Muhammad didn't adopt his slaves. He adopted one particular slave, Zayd ibn Haritha. Zayd was Khadija's slave before she married Muhammad. When she married Muhammad, she gave Zayd to Muhammad as a present. Zayd's parents eventually came looking for him because he'd been kidnapped, and Zayd said that he was going to stay with Muhammad. Muhammad was so impressed that he adopted Zayd, and Zayd was then called Zayd, son of Muhammad. This was before Muhammad declared himself to be a prophet. After Muhammad declared himself to be a prophet, things began to change. One day, Muhammad saw Zayd's wife, Zainab, practically naked, and he walked away praising God. Zayd found out about it and divorced Zainab so that his prophet and adopted father could have her. Muhammad married Zainab, but this caused an uproar in the community because marrying the wife of your own adopted son was frowned upon by everyone. Allah really doesn't like people criticizing Muhammad, so Allah abolished adoption. There's no more adoption in Islam. Zayd was later sent on a raiding expedition and was killed. Notice, Bilal was very selective in the information he presented, and he pretended, deceptively, that Muhammad adopted all of his slaves, when Muhammad abolished adoption in order to justify taking the wife of the one slave he actually adopted. Muhammad's other slaves, and he had many, were simply slaves. And again, Muhammad had sex with his female slaves. Bilal Philips, like every other Muslim leader, wants young Muslims to accept his answer without digging deeper. Is this approach going to stop the avalanche of apostasy? Is it going to stop the tsunami of apostasy? No. Bilal's response here is a perfect example of why the Muslim community is facing an avalanche of apostasy. In the Muslim world, Muslim leaders rely on violence, intimidation, and deception to keep young Muslims from questioning Islam. In the West, Muslim leaders rely primarily on deception, but that deception can only carry Islam so far. Young Muslims are being challenged to defend what they're saying, and when they try to defend it, they find out that it's simply not true. So they're leaving Islam. What's the solution, according to Bilal Philips? More deception, more misinformation, more carefully edited stories that cover up what really happened. Good luck with that, Bilal. You keep lying to young people, and I'll keep seeing them on YouTube.